People have been staring through microscopes for centuries now, peering into the microcosmos and uncovering its beauty as they pursue deeper questions about the world around us. So it might actually surprise you to hear this, but James, our master of microscopes, feels like microscopy is currently coming out of a bit of a funk. A funk that emerged sometime in the middle of the 20th century. But what does that actually mean? And what does it mean for the future of microscopy? Microscopy, like any technique, has evolved over the centuries, but even in its early days, we can see the foundations of a field emerging, one built on unusual sites shared with a broader community. To put it bluntly, we can see what it looks like when people are driven by the very simple question, I wonder what this thing looks like up close. One of the most notable of these early works was Robert Hooke's Micrographia, which was published in 1665. Filled with striking illustrations that Hooke made of various objects placed under the microscope, readers were able to see everything from a flea's body to the tip of a needle in more detail than they ever had before. And those images, with Hooke's writing, would inspire many of its readers. Samuel Pepys, who would eventually become the president of the Royal Society in 1684, reportedly stayed up until 2 a.m. reading Micrographia, and later he called it, quote, the most ingenious book that I ever read in my life. To capture his images, Hooke relied on the artistic skills he learned as an apprentice to a portrait painter. But according to the Huntington Library, there are no surviving portraits of Hooke. The main record of his physical form, they are not of his face. They are the samples from his own body that he contributed to Micrographia, like, for example, his hair. Despite this artistic start to the field, there may be those who are skeptical of calling microscopy an art form. But to us, the very roots of microscopy reveal the creativity born out of its participants and its masters, and their scientific drive to see the world at ever smaller scales. Hooke's contemporaries and successors would continue this, establishing a tradition born out of the combination of words and illustrations. There are the 17th century letters of Antony van Leeuwenhoek, for example, that would introduce the idea of invisible tiny creatures existing in the world around us, creatures that we would one day come to call microbes. And from the 19th century, we have these spectacular illustrations made by Christian Gottfried Ehrenberg, which museum curators would later go to great lengths to preserve so that we can continue to see what Ehrenberg saw. There are plenty of names of this stature firmly embedded in the history of microbiology. They endure in every citation and reference. At the same time, it's hard not to wonder what names have been lost to history, whose microbial observations have remained buried in books that are tucked away in some dusty corner, waiting for someone to stumble upon them. Of course, that question is not possible for us to answer, but even if we don't know those works, we can imagine a host of contributions that were part of a conversation at the time they were published, a conversation built on scientists navigating multiple young scientific disciplines. One of the common questions in those conversations was how to group the organisms scientists observed under the microscope. Classifying nature and creating taxonomies was important not just to satisfy some innate need to group things together, it also had the potential to reveal how organisms evolved. And the impact of the microscope goes far beyond taxonomies. It has helped us examine human tissue and microbial pathogens. It has even set the stage for us to understand the existence of atoms. But over the course of the 20th century, microscopy's importance evolved as well. There were advances during that time that expanded what the microscope was capable of as scientists uncovered techniques like fluorescence microscopy and differential interference contrast. Those advances were great for what James focuses on, optical microscopy, which is the use of beams of light to illuminate samples. But the middle of the 20th century also saw the emergence of scanning electron microscopy, which uses beams of electrons to create scans of a sample. Scanning electron microscopes are powerful, able to reach magnifications that optical microscopes cannot. But the images can only come in grayscale, and it can take much longer to produce an image. Also, they are not as easy to use as optical microscopes. To James's eye, the scanning electron microscope ended up displacing the optical microscope in a number of contexts, but it was not the only tool to do so. Another major advance of the 20th century was in our ability to understand organisms at a genetic level, which allowed scientists to piece together the evolutionary relationships between organisms with far more accuracy. Instead of just reconstructing evolutionary relationships based on, like, a supposed family resemblance, scientists were able to go straight to the molecular record to more accurately reveal those relationships. The results of these studies would then go on to tear apart previously defined relationships between organisms that scientists had assumed existed simply because they looked the same. To be clear, the introduction of these techniques has been great for science. They've exposed us to new corners of the microcosmos and given us insight that wasn't possible before. In many cases, it's even allowed us to look past deceptive resemblances to better understand the microcosmos. But we are, at our core here, lovers of the light microscope. The footage it provides allows us to see the lives of microbes in such a unique way, and it would be a shame to lose that as we shift our focus to the questions that only DNA can answer. If anything, we would hope that these newer techniques would contribute to questions that we can solve better with optical microscopy and vice versa. Beyond its contributions to scientific papers, optical microscopy is beautiful, and it's also accessible in a way that many techniques in science are not, and we think that both of these things are helping it make a bit of a comeback. As we look back on the work we've done on this channel, from exploring what ciliates can teach us about death, to uncovering rare organisms, to witnessing the act of tardigrade copulation, what we hope all of you have taken from going on this journey with us, it is all the possibilities of microscopy. And really, there are so many possibilities. To that end, the videos we're showing you now are from all of you. In the past, we have asked you to share recordings of the footage you take with the Journey to the Microcosmos microscope. So thank you to everyone who has contributed. And we can do that in part thanks to an innovation that allows us to share information and visuals in a way that the earliest microscopists would very likely envy: the internet. Sure, the internet can be a frustrating and difficult place sometimes, but for James, it was instrumental in his start with the microscope, providing sources for him to scour through for hours on end as he first learned how to use his microscope and identify the organisms he saw. It's also been a source of community, like the Facebook group James found, where people were sharing images of the microbes they observed. He's also been a big fan of the microscopy subreddit because people there have been so welcoming and encouraging. And of course, there's all of you here on YouTube and the community that you've created. We asked James what he hopes for in the future of the microscopy community. And he said that he wants it to be a community without competition, where the focus is on compassion and on curiosity. So, when we ask what the future of microscopy looks like, part of the answer is it's up to you. Much like its past, the future of this field is not about any one microscopist. It's about the community and the interactions and the questions we endeavor to answer together. Perhaps then, when we ask what the future of microscopy looks like, we should do what we've always done here on Journey to the Microcosmos. We should look to the microbes, forever enduring, forever evolving, and forever inspiring. So from me and the entire team that has made this show over the years. Thank you all so much for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. We'd also like to say thank you to each and every one of our patrons. Some of their names are on the screen right now, and these are some of the people who help make this channel possible. We are so grateful for your support. If you would like to see more from our Master of Microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram, or you can find his book linked in the description. And if you'd like to see more from us, head on over to youtube.com/complexly.